Recorded Books presents America's Original Sin, White Supremacy, John Wilkes Booth, and the Lincoln Assassination by John Rhodehamel. Narrated by Donald Corren.
Prologue. There's a story of what never happened that's been told thousands of times. A story of political murder and revenge, sorrow and crippling doubt. A family of famous American actors named Booth all knew this story by heart. Father and sons, they'd played it many times. This story is William Shakespeare's tragical history of Hamlet, Prince of Denmark. The father of the acting family, the mad tragedian Junius Brutus Booth, had moved two generations of theatergoers on two continents with his portrayal of the melancholy prince. The older son, Edwin Booth, won enduring fame as the finest Hamlet of them all, becoming the standard to which all actors aspired and none reached, with his 100-night run in the title role in New York City during the last winter of the Civil War. The younger son, John Wilkes Booth, had played Hamlet too, but he won far more fame for his spectacular, violent portrayal of the murderous tyrant Richard III in another of Shakespeare's tragedies. Prince Hamlet is sworn to avenge the murder of his father, King Hamlet. The killer is none other than the dead king's brother, Claudius, Hamlet's uncle, who has elevated himself to the Danish throne by his crime, and in the bargain has incestuously taken his brother's widow, Gertrude, the prince's mother, as his wife. But doubt drains away Hamlet's native resolution. He cannot bring himself to kill. Then, in the third act, the hesitant avenger comes upon his guilty uncle alone and vulnerable. On his knees, his back turned and his eyes closed, Claudius will be easy to dispatch. Hamlet bears his sword. But then the prince, who has thought long and hard about the geographies of the undiscovered country of the dead, is stricken again by doubt. He decides that this is not the time to strike, for Claudius is on his knees in prayer, and to kill him thus clean-souled will be to send him straight to heaven, hardly a fitting punishment for his cold-blooded murder of his own brother, all the more so when Hamlet reflects that his father's own unshriven ghost is consigned to a purgatory of fearful punishment. Hamlet sheathes his sword. Two more acts remain before the stage is strewn with corpses, and the prince perceives that the rest is silence. The irony is that the usurper had been unable to shed his guilt. Claudius remained unforgiven, with no hope of salvation. He couldn't pray. He couldn't repent his crime so long as he continued to enjoy the fruits of that crime. My crown, my known ambition, and my queen. Act 3, Scene 3. Had Hamlet run Claudius through on the spot, his uncle's soul would have been hellbound after all, and Hamlet would have freed himself from the treble-sworn promise of vengeance he had made to his father's perturbed spirit. Another character, well acquainted with sorrow and sometimes troubled by doubt, one Abraham Lincoln of Kentucky, Indiana, and Illinois, was among William Shakespeare's most devoted American admirers. Like the Booths, Lincoln knew Shakespeare by heart. He judged Macbeth, Shakespeare's greatest play, but he thought the despairing Claudius's speech here in Act 3 of Hamlet the finest passage in all the tragedies. Lincoln said that Claudius's soliloquy always struck me as one of the finest touches of nature in the world. Hamlet had let his doubts cancel his resolution, when striking out boldly would have given him his revenge. Like the fictional Hamlet, the actual Abraham Lincoln had known heartache and had often been mired in doubt, particularly in his youth and particularly in matters of faith. Unlike the fictional Hamlet, the actual John Wilkes Booth knew no doubt. Booth was a true believer in a time when millions of American men were proving themselves willing to kill and to die for what they believed. For when his own chance for vengeance came, at the performance of a very different kind of play, Booth never doubted. He knew he was killing for his country and for the white race, and he killed with the expectation that the killing would make him a hero, in the North as well as the South. The actual Booth, didn't hesitate like the fictional Hamlet. Instead, rigid with a terrible certainty, he stepped forward and raised the small pistol in his right hand. Inches separated the muzzle from the back of Lincoln's head. Booth squeezed the trigger. When a few pounds pressure from his index finger tripped the sear, mechanical energy stored in the pistol's mainspring pulled the hammer down onto the copper percussion cap mounted on the steel nipple with its touch hole through the barrel into the firing chamber. A dab of mercury fulminate in the cap exploded. A tiny spark jetted through the touch hole to detonate the gunpowder packed behind the bullet. Chemical energy stored in the black powder instantly became fiery gases, expanding to pressures of thousands of pounds per square inch. The trapped gases shoved mightily against the only movable part of the firing chamber's enclosure, the bullet itself, driving it down the bore and out the muzzle at 400 miles per hour. Unburned powder igniting on contact with oxygen flared in a dazzling muzzle flash, briefly illuminating the presidential box before dissipating as smoke. The explosion rang through the theater. The half-inch leaden sphere crossed the intervening space in a time too short for the instrumentalities of that century to measure, and crashed through the back of Abraham Lincoln's skull, slightly off-center and just above the left lateral sinus. The bullet punched a disc out of the occipital bone and plowed a bloody .44-caliber tunnel strewn with bone chips through the soft tissue of the left posterior lobe of the cerebrum before coming to rest somewhere behind the right eye. The impact cracked the thin bone at the back of Lincoln's eye sockets like eggshell, and blood suffused the sockets. As he lay dying, his eyeballs would bulge out and his face darken with deep bruises. More work for the undertakers. As many as 1 million Americans would look on the president's decaying face in the days that followed. Lincoln raised his right arm convulsively from the armrest. His head dropped forward. He looked as though he were asleep in the big rocking chair. Mary Lincoln screamed. Blue gun smoke drifted lazily out of the box. Booth dropped the pistol and slashed out with his Bowie knife, botched the 12-foot leap to the stage and broke his leg, shouted his last lines, and made his final exit stage right. It had been, Walt Whitman later said, one brief flash of lightning illumination, one simple, fierce deed. Although his lungs continued to breathe and his heart to beat until 7:22 the next morning, Abraham Lincoln was a dead man the instant Booth pulled the trigger. As Carl Sandburg would put it near the end of the sixth and final volume of his sprawling Lincoln biography, for Abraham Lincoln, it was lights out. So it was, while holding his wife's hand on the happiest day of his life. Chapter 1. Richmond, Virginia, April 4th, 1865. Surely the most extraordinary month in American history. April 1865 brought the succession of spectacular events that signaled the final collapse of Southern fortunes in the Civil War. Day by day, April presented new prodigies to an astonished people. For 4 years, America had been locked in a war that sometimes seemed like it might end in the independence of the insurgent slave republic. Now, in the space of just a week, Northern victory came on swiftly as one triumph followed another. The North was delirious with joy. The white South was speechless with despair. Washington City celebrated with bands and fireworks, songs and speeches, beer and whiskey, and citywide grand illuminations with 1 million candles and countless lamps and gas jets burning in every window of every house and every public building up and down every street on every block in every neighborhood until the whole city seemed ablaze. Bonfires burned on every corner. Giant transparent banners bearing patriotic slogans were illuminated from behind like lantern slides. An array of brilliant gas jets spelled out Union in huge letters across the facade of the patent office. Peace, said the lights on the Treasury. Grant, replied the War Department. Rockets arced across the sky. Thousands of drunks stumbled through the streets singing, shouting, and laughing, intoxicated by sheer happiness as much as by alcohol. A reporter did comment on the strange affinity between patriotism and whiskey. To the east loomed the great white-painted iron dome of the U.S. Capitol, completed just 2 years before, now illuminated by tiers of lights in the misty night air, seeming to float on the horizon like a full moon. The window-shattering thunder of the 800-gun salute on Monday, April 3rd for the capture of Richmond was topped a week later on Monday, April 10th, by the roar of 900 cannon celebrating the surrender of Robert E. Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, the final giving way that marked the effective end of the war. Perhaps Walt Whitman captured best the indescribable emotions stirring the Northern people when he wrote that, over all and saturating all, that vast, vague wonder, victory, the nation's victory, the triumph of the Union, was filling the air, the thought, the sense, with exhilaration. Between those two signal victories had appeared the other worldly vision of President Abraham Lincoln's risky walking tour through the still-burning southern capital, where he was greeted as a modern-day savior by the hosannas of newly freed people wild with joy, as white Virginians watched the end of their world from behind shuttered windows. After rowing miles up the James River, skirting shipwrecks, dead horses, and mines packed with hundreds of pounds of gunpowder, Admiral David Dixon Porter's barge nosed up to the Richmond Landing, and Abraham Lincoln stepped out. The enemy's government had evacuated its capital city just a day before, on the night and morning of Sunday to Monday, April 2nd to 3rd. They had fled because U.S. Grant had finally pried Robert E. Lee out of his trenches, ending the long siege of Petersburg. Also ended was any hope of holding Richmond. Now the rebellion's champion army was disintegrating in its final retreat, hemorrhaging thousands of dead and wounded, prisoners and deserters, as the Army of Northern Virginia went reeling west toward collapse at Appomattox, aggressively pursued by Grant's exultant regiments. Lee's grim survivors were starving, barefoot, and profoundly discouraged. What remained of the enslaver's government, still headed by Jefferson Davis, was also in flight, jammed aboard the passenger cars of a single train that rattled slowly south along the decrepit tracks of the last remaining railroad out of Richmond. Before fleeing the city on the windy night of April 2nd, the retreating Southerners had torched tobacco warehouses, ammunition depots, and bridges, setting off the conflagration that consumed Richmond's business district. More than 750,000 artillery shells exploded as the ordnance dumps went up, creating spectacular pyrotechnic displays and showering the city with shrapnel and flaming debris. Just before dawn, the last ironclad warships of the rebel navy were blown up in the river with earth-shaking detonations. Union soldiers, including the regiments of the United States colored troops that had been among the first to enter the fallen city, were still fighting the flames when the president came ashore around midday Tuesday, April 4th. The sailors whose strong arms had propelled the barge upriver presently laid aside their oars and shouldered carbines to become a meager presidential bodyguard. Six marched in front of him, four behind. Flanked by officers, the president walked along in the middle, holding the hand of his younger son, Tad. It happened to be Tad's 12th birthday. If Lincoln had imprudently risked his safety on the voyage up the James River, the mile-and-a-half trek from the shore to the center of the city represented an even more irresponsible exposure of a life that was so precious to the nation. Mobs of wildly excited people, white and black, had ruled the streets of Richmond for 36 hours. There were crowds of the formerly enslaved, delirious with their new freedom. There were drunken rebel deserters and stragglers, still in their gray uniforms. Escaped inmates from the penitentiary, leaping, shouting demons, were running wild with their shaved heads and bold-striped prisoner suits. Hungry for months, Many Richmonders hurried along, carrying bags of flour and sides of bacon stolen from government warehouses. Every store and warehouse that escaped the flames had been broken open and looted. The air was thick with smoke and dust, and the stink of burning tobacco and gunpowder. Into this maelstrom, the president set off on foot with his young son. As he said himself, "I walked alone on the street, and anyone could have shot me from a second-story window." Abraham Lincoln was the most photographed and caricatured president in history. Even here, in the city that had so recently been the seat of the rebellion, his was an unmistakable figure. Dressed in black, his gaunt 6'4" frame stretched even taller by the iconic stovepipe hat, he was recognized instantly as the little party made its way into the city. The black people of Richmond, most of them suddenly free for the first time in their lives, proclaimed him their savior. "Glory, hallelujah," they shouted. "Massa Lincoln has come, the great Messiah. I knowed him as soon as I seed him. Come to free his children from bondage." A reporter for a Boston newspaper called it a spectacle, such wild, indescribable, ecstatic joy I never before have witnessed. "Thank you, dear Jesus, for this," shouted one freed woman. Another declared, "I know that I am free, for I have seen Father Abraham and touched him." The journalist continued, "It was the great deliverer meeting the delivered. Yesterday morning, the majority of the thousands who crowded the streets and hindered our advance were slaves. Now they were free, beholding him who had given them liberty." Throngs of them crowded forward to grasp or touch his hands or brush against his clothing. As Lincoln acknowledged the acclamations, the reporter thought he saw tears in the president's eyes. When a white-haired black man doffed his ragged straw hat, bowed low, and said, "May the good Lord bless you and keep you safe, Master Lincoln," the president lifted his own hat and bowed in return. Lincoln was stern, however, when some of the freed people knelt down before him. "Don't kneel to me," he said. "That is not right. You must kneel to God only, and thank him for the liberty you will enjoy hereafter." Lincoln's bow to the old man had been a stunning rebuke to white supremacy. Witnessing it, one white woman had angrily turned away, snorting in disgust. The next issue of the Atlantic Monthly did not exaggerate in its assertion that Lincoln's bow upset the forms, laws, customs, and ceremonies of centuries. It was a death shock to chivalry and a mortal wound to caste. Finally, a squad of cavalry galloped up to accompany the presidential party the rest of the way to Union Army headquarters in Jefferson Davis's home, the mansion known as the White House of the Confederacy. There, Lincoln, who had been sweating freely on the hike up from the river, collapsed wearily into Davis's chair and asked for a glass of water. When officers offered him a celebratory shot of whiskey, the president, who didn't drink alcohol, quietly declined. The reporter thought that he wore a look of unutterable weariness, as if his spirit, energy, and animating force were wholly exhausted. Lincoln had lost 30 pounds and aged a good decade in the 4 years since taking office. Throughout those years of killing, the president had been haunted by the ghostly presence of the ever-growing battalions of the dead, fallen in a war his election had touched off. "If there is a worse place than hell, I am in it," he told one friend. "If there is a man out of perdition who suffers more than I do, I pity him." He was worn out by the never-ending work and the lonely burden of leadership. "Sometimes I think I am the tiredest man on earth," he said. Later, after lunch, the president toured the city in an open carriage. The freed people renewed their displays of irrepressible joy and affection. A black reporter for a Philadelphia paper wrote that the colored population was wild with enthusiasm. Old men thanked God in a very boisterous manner, and old women shouted upon the pavement. A 12-acre square enclosed the venerable Virginia State Capitol, the neoclassical pile Thomas Jefferson had designed at the end of the Revolutionary War. An American flag now flew again over the building that 2 days before had been the seat of the insurgents' government. Lincoln passed through the Jeffersons' old capital, walking through hastily abandoned chambers strewn with worthless currency and government documents. Presiding in the rotunda was Houdon's magnificent 1792 marble statue of George Washington, a slaveholding Virginian who would have opposed secession with all his heart. The square outside was filled to overflowing with freed people and refugees with the pathetic heaps of furniture and belongings they'd managed to pull from their burning homes. Until the day before, no African American had been allowed to enter Capitol Square. Now the grounds were crowded with them. Lincoln spoke to them. "My poor friends, you are free as air. You can cast off the name of slave and trample upon it. It will come to you no more. Liberty is your birthright. God gave it to you as he gave it to others, and it is a sin that you have been deprived of it for so many years." Then he made his exit in a most dramatic fashion. The Boston newspapermen told how Lincoln drove away. Slowly his vehicle moved as he bowed and threw his salutations to those who were ready to worship him. The carriage crossed the open space and halted in the street beyond. Mr. Lincoln arose from the back seat, on which he had been sitting, turned half around, faced the great multitude of blacks who thronged the area behind his carriage, and reached out his hands till he stood in the attitude of a minister pronouncing the benediction. Thus he remained, without speaking a word, for more than a minute, while the carriage stood still. And when the horses moved forward, in the same attitude, he was driven out of sight. Richmond's racial divide had never been more starkly evident than on the streets of the city the day of Lincoln's visit. After he came, the jubilant crowds were almost entirely black. White residents had shut themselves up in their homes. Nothing about the fall of Richmond, not even the fire that burned some 700 buildings, was as stunning to people as the sight of the United States colored troops, a vision of a new reality that white and black Virginians greeted with markedly different feelings. For blacks, soldiers of their own race coming to rescue their people from slavery was the millennium itself, the long-awaited Day of Jubilee. For most white Virginians, it was the ultimate nightmare, armed slaves in full revolt, but one that came with a surprising twist. For generations, Southern whites had dreaded a mass slave rebellion like the horror show in the French colony of Haiti in the 1790s. They had envisioned a merciless race war, darkened by murder, rapine, and arson. The great American slave rebellion finally came to pass in the Civil War, but instead of coming as midnight assassins, the rebels came as regulars, just as Frederick Douglass had predicted. The brass letters U.S. glinting on their collars, the American eagle screaming from the gold-gilt buttons on their blue tunics, and 58-caliber rifle muskets across their shoulders. The colored regiments entered the city singing John Brown's Body, a hymn to the abolitionist boogeyman whose example was so feared and detested by the enslavers. Then the men turned out of their ranks to begin fighting the fires. In its comprehensive repudiation of the old order of white supremacy and black subordination, the scene in Richmond that day was the Dixie Armageddon, a Southern Gutadomerong. Nearly as disturbing to the enslavers as the sight of armed blacks was the joyous welcome given the hated enemy by the enslaved people of Richmond, who many whites had fooled themselves into believing were loyal and grateful servants, content in their lives of bondage. The first Union regiment to enter the fallen city the day before Lincoln's visit had been the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry, a unit of mounted black troopers commanded by Colonel Charles Francis Adams, Jr., grandson of President John Quincy Adams and son of Lincoln's minister to Great Britain. The troopers' appearance excited surges of wild enthusiasm among Richmond's newly freed people. Black joy was paired with white despair. As Lincoln's presidential secretaries John G. Nicolay and John Hay later reflected in their 10-volume Court History of the Administration, the arrival of these black soldiers was to the people of Richmond the visible realization of the new order to which 4 years of rebellion and war had brought them. The prejudices of a lifetime cannot be instantly overcome, and the rebels of Richmond doubtless felt that this was the final drop in their cup of misery, and that their subjugation was complete. It is related that about this time, as by a common impulse, the white people of Richmond disappeared from the streets, and the black population streamed forth with an apparent instinctive recognition that their day of jubilee had at last arrived. To see this compact, organized body of men of their own color, on horseback, in neat uniforms, with flashing sabers, with the gleam of confidence and triumph in their eyes, was a palpable, living reality to which their hope and pride, long repressed, gave instant response. They greeted them with expressions of welcome in every form, cheers, shouts, laughter, and a rattle of exclamations, as they rushed along the sides of the streets to keep pace with the advancing column and feast their eyes on the incredible sight, while the black Union soldiers rose high in their stirrups and with waving swords and deafening huzzas acknowledged the fraternal reception. "You've come at last," the crowds shouted. "We've been looking for you these many days." Indeed, the provision of President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation for enlisting African Americans in the Union Army in 1863 had been almost as radical as emancipation itself. Fielding black soldiers was a true revolution. As historian James McPherson has written, the policy marked the transformation of a war to save the Union into a war to overthrow the old order, of slavery and white supremacy. By war's end, some 180,000 black soldiers, about 135,000 of them formerly enslaved, had marched in the ranks. They did much more than merely garrison forts, positions, and stations, as the proclamation had originally mandated. They fought in some of the bloodiest battles of the war. Their foes often gave them no quarter, slaughtering them when they tried to surrender. Another 19,000 black men served in the U.S. Navy. About 40,000 men, approximately 20% of the total number of black warriors, gave their lives. These men killed slavery. Lincoln said the North could not have won the war without them. Yet to the millions of America's white supremacists, men like the famous young actor John Wilkes Booth, emancipation and the fielding of black regiments were despicable acts of barbarism, as well as an explicit invitation to the apocalyptic race war Southerners had so long dreaded. Jefferson Davis, the so-called president of the rebellion that had styled itself a nation, quickly denounced the Emancipation Proclamation as the most execrable measure recorded in the history of guilty man. Yet his words seemed almost restrained, alongside the howls of execration that greeted news that the Union Army was being strengthened by tens of thousands of black men. The black fighters presented a living, breathing refutation of some of white supremacy's most cherished beliefs, that whites would always dominate non-whites, that the enslaved people were content in their bondage, and that African-American men lacked the character, intelligence, devotion, and discipline to make good soldiers. In the most perverse of ironies, by the end of 1864, their military fortunes had fallen so low that Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee decided to start forcing enslaved soldiers to fight for the preservation of slavery. When denouncing the plan, one Southern statesman had objected, "If slaves make good soldiers, our whole theory of slavery is wrong." At places like Battery Wagner and Port Hudson, the good soldiers of the United States colored troops soon succeeded in proving that the enslavers' theories were indeed wrong. Today, the label white supremacist calls to mind radical extremists, wild-eyed fanatics with shaved heads and swastika tattoos, characters most Americans abhor. In the Civil War era, to the contrary, to hold white supremacist beliefs was anything but radical. Such opinions were then both respectable and utterly conventional, commonly shared by statesmen and politicians, journalists, scientists, educators, and clergymen, indeed, by almost all white people, in the North as well as the South. Racist pseudoscience had proved that non-white people were inferior to Northern Europeans. According to its 19th century proponents, white supremacy rested on two related premises. First, that blacks were born inferior to whites, inferior intellectually, morally, and in some respects physically. Second, white supremacists thought that whenever two peoples of differing capabilities inhabit a single nation, the superior race must dominate the inferior. Without such a system of race control, warfare will inevitably break out between the two different peoples, ending in death or exile for the losers. Slavery provided such a system of social control in the Old South. Jefferson Davis claimed that a superior race had used the institution of slavery to mold brutal savages into docile, intelligent, and civilized agricultural laborers. In the words of that shining avatar of Southern defiance, John C. Calhoun of South Carolina, "Where two races of different origin and distinguished by color and other physical differences, as well as intellectual, are brought together, the relation now existing in the slaveholding states between the two is, instead of an evil, a good, a positive good." The end of slavery, Calhoun maintained, would substitute for the existing relation a deadly strife between the two races, to end in the subjection, expulsion, or extirpation of one or the other. Despite the ominous talk of one or the other surviving a race war, the defenders of slavery never doubted that the whites would prevail and the blacks go under. The former slaves would be destroyed by the more numerous, better armed, and superior whites. So, the argument went, keeping these people enslaved protected them and assured their survival. Even before Thomas Jefferson had presented the proposition in his 1785 Notes on the State of Virginia, it had been an article of faith among the defenders of slavery that emancipation would inevitably lead to the extinction of blacks. The freed people, furious to revenge generations of injustices visited on them, would attack the white masters who had harmed them. Deep-rooted prejudices entertained by the whites, Jefferson argued, as well as 10,000 recollections by the blacks of injuries they have sustained, will divide us into parties and produce convulsions. These convulsions could only end in black annihilation. Another founder and president, John Adams, no defender of slavery himself, had envisioned the same grim outcome. "I can see nothing but insurrections of the blacks against the whites, and massacres by the whites in their turn of the blacks, till at last the whites, exasperated to madness, shall be wicked enough to exterminate the Negroes." Years later, denouncing the Emancipation Proclamation, Jefferson Davis echoed Jefferson and Adams when he said that by Lincoln's provisions, several millions of human beings of an inferior race, peaceful and contented laborers in their sphere, are doomed to extinction. Moreover, the defenders of slavery, statesmen and writers like Edmund Ruffin, James Henry Hammond, John C. Calhoun, and George Fitzhugh, agreed that true republican liberty was possible only in a slave society governed by white supremacy. The South, not the North, was the real home of republican equality among white citizens. Jefferson Davis explained how white supremacy raised even the lowliest Southern white to equality with the upper classes. The lower race of human beings that constitute the substratum of what is termed the slave population of the South elevates every white man in our community. Hence it is that the mechanic in our Southern states is admitted to the table of his employer, converses with him on terms of equality, not merely political equality, but on actual equality, wherever the two men come in contact. It is the presence of a lower caste, those lower by their mental and physical organization, controlled by the higher intellect of the white man, that gives this superiority to the white laborer. Menial services are not there performed by the white man. We have none of our brethren sunk to the degradation of being menials. That belongs to the lower race, the descendants of Ham, who, under the judgment of God speaking to the prophet Noah, were condemned to be servants. The fiction of racial superiority provided a gratifying inspiration to many discouraged whites. W. J. Cash, a historian of the American South, writing in 1941, remarked on how the poor Southern white man, who owned no slaves himself, would take his stand as a strong defender of the institution that had awarded him the dear treasure of his superiority as a white man, which has been conferred on him by slavery, and so was determined to keep the black man in chains. Some have continued to cling to this comforting illusion a century and a half after the 13th Amendment destroyed slavery forever. As President Lyndon B. Johnson once observed, "If you can convince the lowest white man he's better than the best colored man, he won't notice you're picking his pocket. Hell, give him somebody to look down on and he'll empty his pockets for you." Back in Richmond that day, the Commander-in-Chief's military excursion presently came to an end. Lincoln took leave of his generals and admirals. He spent a few hours in the vast hospitals at City Point, shaking hands with 7,000 sick and wounded soldiers, rebels and Yanks alike, going at it, he said, like a man sawing wood. The president finally left the war front on Sunday, April 9th. He wouldn't learn until late in the evening that Lee had surrendered that day to Grant at Appomattox Courthouse. The surrender ceremony had been taking place even as the president's steamship, the River Queen, pushed its way up the broad tidewater Potomac. Aboard the ship, probably to forestall unwelcome discussions of Reconstruction policy, the president chose to pass the time by reading Shakespeare aloud for hours to his shipboard companions. His wife, Mary, and a little collection of officers, politicians, diplomats, and reporters. He read twice, for emphasis, a favorite passage from Macbeth. "Duncan is in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst. Not steel nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further." So Abraham Lincoln and his friends steamed up the Potomac to the White House, where he would live out the 5 days of life remaining to him. Chapter 2. All Those Goddamned Booths. "All those goddamned Booths are crazy," muttered the famous comedian Joseph Jefferson when he heard that John Wilkes Booth had murdered President Lincoln. This is not, however, an altogether satisfactory explanation for the first American presidential assassination. Indeed, the first political murder of any significance in the 76 years of the young republic's history. The story begins in the London winter of 1820-21, when the brilliant young actor Junius Brutus Booth joined his life with that of Mary Ann Holmes. Mr. Booth was 24, Miss Holmes only 18. Theirs was a love match. The couple would be parted only by the death of Junius 31 years later. And their love gifted them 10 children, 6 of whom lived to adulthood. The 9th of the 10 babies was a son, born in Harford County, Maryland, on May 10, 1838. Mary Ann and Junius named their little boy John Wilkes Booth. There is ample evidence that Junius, though an accomplished seducer from the age of 12, remained faithful to his pretty Covent Garden flower girl. 20 years after the couple ran off to America, Junius was still signing his letters, "Your husband and worshipper." It was not an entirely accurate subscription, however. That he worshipped her is not to be doubted, but Junius was not Mary's husband. For any wedding vows they may have exchanged, the Booth children were taught that their parents were married in January 1821, had been a legal fiction. Booth already had a wife and child. Years later, Asia Booth Clark tried to dismiss her father's first marriage as a boyish mésalliance, contracted in Brussels in the year 1814. The record shows, however, that Junius Brutus Booth was in fact a bigamist, an attribute that would find its place in a catalog that eventually included genius, madman, drunk, polyglot scholar, farmer, animal lover and vegetarian, homicidal maniac, and, in the words of the Dictionary of American Biography, easily the foremost tragedian of his day. His father, Richard Booth, was a hard-drinking London lawyer and something of a fanatic on the subject of the Great Republic. In 1777, when he was barely more than a boy, Richard Booth and a cousin, utterly infatuated with republicanism, had seized on the idea of going to America and taking up arms against their native Britain in the Revolutionary War, then raging on that distant continent. They got as far as Paris. There, an American diplomat to whom they applied for Continental Army commissions demanded they first produce letters of recommendation from some notable British friend of American liberty. The two boys went straight back to their hotel and wrote to the foremost English radical of the day, John Wilkes, an ardent supporter of the American cause. The Booths were related by marriage to the famous agitator. The letter's recipient may have been mildly gratified to learn that the two young men were spurred by an ardent desire to serve the glorious cause of freedom. But, whatever he thought, John Wilkes was not about to vouch for a pair of strangers he suspected to be minors. He wrote at once to young Booth's father, who speedily dispatched agents to Paris to catch the runaway and bring him back to London. It was the last truly rebellious act of Richard Booth's life. He returned to the legal apprenticeship he had fled. By 1790, London directories listed him as a lawyer practicing in the city. But there was more than a nod to rebellion in the name that the lawyer Booth gave his son. Junius Brutus Booth fairly sang with republican music, with the heady notion that rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God. It was a name that called to mind the legendary founders of the Roman Republic, the heroes who threw out the last kings of the ancient city-state and fought to prevent the restoration of a Roman monarchy. In 18th-century England, Junius had also been the pen name adopted by a well-known anti-government pamphleteer. The most famous namesake of all was, of course, Marcus Junius Brutus, the assassin hero of the dying Roman Republic. Brutus was one of the killers of Julius Caesar, the would-be autocrat whose name itself became the root word for royal titles like Tsar and Kaiser that bespoke the most swollen tyranny. Brutus, the noblest Roman of them all, was one of the principal roles in Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, a play the Booths, father and sons, would act in many times. The name of Brutus would echo down the generations of the Booth family, resonating in the highest tragedy ever enacted in the American Republic the young Richard Booth had so longed to serve. In the last words he scribbled into his little pocket diary, the despairing, hunted, injured, death-bound John Wilkes Booth would identify himself a final time with Roman Brutus, the tyrant killer. One of the assassin's theatrical friends even claimed that the actor's admiration for the classical Brutus was the mainspring of the assassination. "Sic semper tyrannis," Booth would shout like a Roman the moment he sent his bullet crashing through Lincoln's head. "Thus always to tyrants," translated of the defiant motto that adorned the obverse of the great seal of the Commonwealth of Virginia. After his death, an anonymous poem that circulated through the South eulogized Booth as our Brutus. If Richard Booth had expected better from John Wilkes in 1777, he clearly never lost his admiration for the old Republican stalwart. 60 years after he sent his fruitless appeal from Paris, Richard Booth persuaded his son Junius to bestow the English agitator's name on Richard's infant grandson, John Wilkes Booth. The boy was proud of his middle name. "It means liberty," he would explain. After Junius Brutus Booth had learned and abandoned printing, mastered Latin, Greek, French, Spanish, and Hebrew, toyed with painting, sculpture, and literature, and had almost gone to sea, He studied law for a while in his father's office. He found the law dry and turgid. Nor were he and his father particularly happy with each other. Richard Booth's legal skills were of little use when Junius was guilty as charged in two paternity suits. The first, the result of his acquaintance with a servant girl named Molly when he was only 12. The second came 5 years later, when another girl accused Junius of a deed of darkness that her situation could no longer conceal. His father had to pay up. But the moment he first stood on a stage, Junius Brutus Booth knew that he had found his calling. He saw at once that the actor's higher art transcended poetry, painting, and sculpture. He had already fallen in love with the theater. Othello was the first play he saw. Inspired, he devoured Shakespeare and a host of other dramatists, memorized speeches, and ran through parts in his head. From the beginning, the aspirant's favorite character was the hunchbacked royal villain in Colley Cibber's popular adaptation of Shakespeare's Richard III. As he repeated Richard's lines to himself, he dreamed of one day projecting Shakespeare's mighty word to hundreds of upturned faces. Much against his father's wishes, he joined a company of roving players as an extra, earning £1 a week. He made his debut in 1813 in the undistinguished comedy John Bull, before an undistinguished audience in a converted cow barn on London's Pancras Street. Junius Brutus Booth was 17 years old. He would follow the actor's road, with fits and starts, with odd excursions, episodes of intoxication and madness, and flashes of sublime artistry, for all of the 39 years that remained to him. A player's calling in the 19th century meant a life of travel. The year of 1814 found Booth performing on the continent. In Brussels, he made another female acquaintance, Adelaide Delannoy, his landlady's daughter. Booth was now 18, Adelaide 3 or 4 years his senior. Before long, Adelaide was scaling her mother's garden wall to meet the lover waiting in the darkness. The two eloped, or rather ran off together, since they were not to be married for several months. They eluded pursuit by the young lady's angry family. Madame Delannoy's still unmarried daughter was pregnant. The lovers went to London and moved in with Richard Booth. Late in May 1815, Adelaide could write her mother, "Very dear mother, it is with the greatest pleasure in the world that I inform you I am married to Booth since the 8th of May, and am the happiest of women. I am as well as I can be, and I am getting as fat as a great beast." In October, Adelaide gave birth to a daughter, Amelia. For the next 2 years, Booth paid his dues with circuits of provincial engagements, building his strength and learning some of the roles that would make him famous. His big break came in 1817, when a stage manager drafted him to stand in for Edmund Kean, the preeminent English actor of the day. That night, the 21-year-old played the role of Sir Giles Overreach in A New Way to Pay Old Debts. Striding from the stage in a storm of applause after the final curtain fell, the young actor boasted that he'd just given his audience the goddamnedest show they had ever seen. Waking the next morning, he discovered he was a star. The Oxford English Dictionary informs us that, as early as 1779, the term star has been used to mean an actor, singer, etc., of exceptional celebrity. The critical and popular acclaim the young actor won with that single performance was the making of him. He soon opened as Richard III at the Covent Garden, one of London's two principal theaters. At £1,000 a year, the young actor, who had so recently been earning £1 a week, now made more than his lawyer father, who may have taken some pride in his son for the first time. But Junius was still not satisfied. He had success, but not preeminent stardom. The established veteran Kean still held that crown. The rivalry with other actors was embittering, and Booth was erratic. His performances remained uneven. Yet any response from an audience that fell short of worshipful rapture hurt him into thinking that the ignorant public failed to grasp the true range of his genius. He was not above manifesting his disdain for the unappreciative. He was chased out of a Manchester theater by an angry mob of textile workers he had insulted as low-lived button makers. His earnings sometimes disappointed him. He also found, to his disgust, that any theatrical career was likely to be entangled in lawsuits, feuds, unpaid fees, and contractual fights. More than anything else, however, it was probably his soured marriage that made him so ready for a change. Little Amelia had died in infancy, but a second child, Richard Junius, was born to the Booths in 1819. Still, it may be surmised that it was not a happy marriage. He was ready to throw over his entire life. In the fall of 1820, he tripped over what he had been looking for in the person of Mary Ann Holmes, a teenage flower girl who sold her wares in Covent Garden, the shopping neighborhood that surrounded the theaters. Mary Ann's history is obscure. She was the daughter of a seedsman named Robert Holmes, a pious shopkeeper who sold grain, seeds, bulbs, and flowers. The shopkeeper's girl was a rung or two below the lawyer's boy on the English social ladder, but she was beautiful. Booth was handsome. His sublime and astonishing interpretation of King Lear was then the sensation of all London. Mary Ann had seen him in the role. Both were smitten. Students of the Booth family once advanced the notion that Junius practiced a double deception on the two women in his life. He told Adelaide his stage career would benefit from an American tour that would mean the temporary separation of husband from wife and child, while going through the charade of a fake marriage to fool Mary Ann. The man was, after all, a gifted actor. But the diary of a London theater manager, preserved in the Huntington Library, reveals that Mary Ann's parents knew that their daughter had run off with a married man. Mary Ann obviously knew it, too. It is more plausible that Adelaide Delanoy Booth really did not yet know that her husband had deserted her for another woman. Events would show that Adelaide had no intention of renouncing her claim to be Booth's only lawful wedded wife. Either way, Booth found himself in a tight spot. He decided to leave England. His daughter, Asia Booth Clark, later claimed, with a straight face, that a desire to visit the West Indies professionally prompted the journey. The couple departed Britain for Madeira. From there, they caught a clipper ship that carried them to America in 44 days. The merchantman had no berths for passengers, but Booth rented the captain's own cabin. They took along Junius's favorite pet, a little horse named Peacock. Mary Ann was also carrying their first child, to be named Junius Brutus Booth Jr., who would be born the first of the American Booths, in Charleston, South Carolina, several months later. The tour turned out to be more than a professional visit. Like so many who made the westward passage, the Booths became Americans. Booth stepped ashore at Norfolk, Virginia, on June 30, 1821. He appeared on an American stage for the first time a week later in Richmond, the nearby Virginia capital. Some there were doubtful that this little stranger really was, as he claimed, the celebrated English tragedian Junius Brutus Booth. But the manager of Richmond's Marshall Theater was willing to risk booking the boy, 25, Booth looked about 16, in that actor's most famous role, Richard III. The player the audience saw that night was a small man of about 5'3", with dark hair and piercing gray-blue eyes that could look black in the stage lights. He was possessed of a splendid voice he had learned to wield with both preternatural precision and impassioned feeling. He also possessed fire and conviction, a wide-ranging intellect nurtured by much reading, and a prodigious memory for lines that even alcohol could not often overthrow. His reputation had preceded him. The Virginians already knew him as one of the foremost dramatic actors in the English-speaking world. The eager actor, probably short on funds, immediately arranged to repeat Richard III the following evening in nearby Petersburg. Unlike his first performance in Richmond, in Petersburg there were observers, both on the stage and among the audience, who left accounts that hint at the powers Booth had brought with him across the Atlantic. The Petersburg theater manager and his players had also greeted with a certain skepticism the unprepossessing stranger's claim to be the famous London actor. He arrived late for rehearsal and covered with dust from the 25-mile trek from Richmond. He'd missed the stagecoach. He ran through the rehearsal like an apathetic student reciting a lesson. "That will do," he said. After the curtain went up, the young Briton listlessly mumbled his way through the opening scenes. Skepticism became conviction. The man was an impostor. Then, without warning, Booth revealed himself, stepping into character as the gloating killer. Eyes widened, and hairs pricked up on the backs of arms and necks. Almost against their will, the Virginians found themselves thrilled and terrified as Booth bestirred himself to turn on them his raw, inexplicable power. These were only the first of countless American audiences to be so moved. Booth's performances could be so riveting that his fellow actors sometimes forgot their lines. Struck dumb, they stood frozen in place, staring at the prodigy. Sometimes he had the entire cast, extras and all, as well as the audience, in tears. He scared some of his leading ladies right off the stage. His combat scenes were so ferocious, he might knock his stage opponents out cold or leave them covered with blood. As Othello, he once came close to smothering the actress playing Desdemona. Richard III was always his most celebrated role, and of the whole tragedy, the actor's most celebrated scene was the final fight to the death, the sword play that kills King Richard and ends the play. Junius Brutus Booth sometimes refused to follow Shakespeare's stage directions to die by the sword of the upright Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond, the ancestor of Shakespeare's reigning monarch, Queen Elizabeth. One night, heatedly exchanging blows with an unfortunate fellow actor playing Richmond, the eminent tragedian decided that he was not ready to die just yet. A storm of blows from his stage sword drove this Richmond off the stage, up the aisle, past the audience, out onto the sidewalk, and finally into the tavern next door. The drinkers there disarmed the distracted man. One of the actor's most devoted admirers was the poet Walt Whitman. He could never forget Booth's Richard III. I can see again Booth's quiet entrance from the side, as with head bent, he slowly and in silence, amid the tempest of boisterous hand-clapping, walks down the stage to the footlights with that peculiar and abstracted gesture, musingly kicking his sword, which he holds off from him by its sash. Though 50 years have passed since then, I can still hear the clank and feel the perfect following hush of perhaps 3,000 people waiting. I never saw an actor who could make more of the said hush or wait and hold the audience in an indescribable, half-delicious, half-irritating suspense. A shudder went through every nervous system in the audience. His genius was to me one of the grandest revelations of my life, a lesson of artistic expression. The words fire, energy, abandon found in him unprecedented meanings. I never heard a speaker or actor who could give such a sting to hauteur or the taunt. I never heard from any other the charm of unswervingly perfect vocalization. To Whitman, Booth was simply the grandest histrion of modern times. For though those brilliant years had many fine and even magnificent actors, undoubtedly at Booth's death in 1852 went the last and by far the noblest Roman of them all. At the same time, Whitman said that Junius Brutus Booth illustrated Plato's rule that to the forming of an artist of the very highest rank, a dash of insanity, or what the world calls insanity, is indispensable. The actor's daughter, Asia, alluded to her father's slight aberrations of mind, which marked that exquisite turning point between genius and madness. In her father's case, Asia continued, these aberrations seemed to increase in strength and frequency with maturer years. Within a few months of his arrival, Booth had played New York, Norfolk, Richmond, Petersburg, New Orleans, and Savannah. Marianne remained hidden away in Charleston during her confinement and delivery. Booth didn't want news of his domestic arrangements appearing in the press and reaching back across the Atlantic. Success came quickly. His travels, Asia Booth Clark later claimed, constituted one long ovation. From his first night, then, Junius Brutus Booth found, on American stages, the preeminence that had eluded him in London. The United States was still a cultural backwater. However Booth may have ranked against Edmund Kean, there was not another actor in America who even came close. Embedded in a stanza of indifferent verse cut into the obelisk that rises above his grave in a Baltimore cemetery is a five-word tag that sums up Booth's career in his new country. Of tragedy, the mighty chief. So he was for more than 30 years. But it was not to be an entirely unbroken train of ovations. One sketch explains that, owing to his attacks of madness, his intemperance, and his general irresponsibility, Booth broke his theatrical engagements with reckless frequency, and on more than one occasion, when irritated, came forward to the footlights and expressed his contempt for the audience. But the public always forgave him because of his unquestioned ability. Coming to America, Booth had succeeded in leaving behind his old life and his old wife, his enemies, creditors, and rivals, but he could not escape his demons. By 1824, the demons were growing bolder. There was a sudden flaring of madness on a New York street, ignited by a false report of Marianne's death. The report was some 60 years premature. Booth attacked a fellow actor with a knife. He almost killed him. Restrained, he was soon himself again. The newspapers reported the episode. With increasing frequency, Booth's life would be punctuated by spells of derangement, self-destruction, and inexplicable homicidal fury. It was a mercy that he never actually killed anyone, or himself. By the time John was born, John Wilkes Booth's biographer Terry Alford has written, Junius had compiled an unenviable resume of trouble. He had shot one man in the face, assaulted others, attempted suicide on three occasions, and been jailed in four states. His long-suffering wife once had to cut him down when she discovered him hanging from a noose. While some journalists accused him of staging his mad freaks to titillate the public and swell his box office, there is no doubt that Junius Brutus Booth was authentically, if only episodically, crazy. There are many stories about him, about his acting, his drinking, his violence, and his sheer craziness. And a good many of these stories were very likely true. John Wilkes Booth once complained to his sister Asia, I cannot see why sensible people will trouble themselves to concoct ridiculous stories of their great actors. We know that two-thirds of the funny anecdotes about our own father are disgraceful falsehoods. Johnny hardly seemed to notice that he was conceding that a third of the wild stories were quite true. Junius's sons had theatrical ambitions of their own, but if they were to be heir to their father's disorder as well as his talent, it promised to be a fearsome legacy indeed. Booth's eccentricities were so well known that the papers started billing him as the Mad Tragedian. In April 1838, his hometown paper, the Baltimore Sun, reported that Mr. Booth, the Mad Tragedian, has arrived in our city. Then, on May 3rd, the Sun blasted the actor, who had stood up another audience. Booth again! Is this man a maniac, or is he not more fool than madman? Booth is a genius, is the cry, and he has heard it reiterated so often that he imagines his vagaries will be overlooked. But we can inform him that in this city he is eternally disgraced. Exactly 1 week after this notice appeared, on May 10, 1838, John Wilkes Booth was born at the farm north of Baltimore. Years later, when Americans were trying to explain away the white supremacists' politically motivated murder of Abraham Lincoln as a meaningless aberration, as one mad act somehow outside of history, the father's reputation made it easy to claim that the son had been crazy too. This persistent charge of insanity became part of the legend that has attached itself to the person of the Republic's first presidential assassin. For although he was certainly extremely angry, John Wilkes Booth was never mad. The gunfire that had disfigured our public life in the years since John Wilkes Booth's murderous encounter with Abraham Lincoln has made Americans all too familiar with assassination. There remains, however, a longing to deny that the violence is purposeful. We see this denial in the tendency to ignore the political dimensions of assassination in the United States. One study, prepared by a governmental commission, concluded that assassins of American presidents, including Booth, were, for the most part, mentally disturbed persons who did not kill in advance of any rational political plan. That judgment is simply mistaken. Most attacks on presidents and presidential candidates have been politically motivated. John Wilkes Booth set the pattern when he killed Abraham Lincoln for clearly articulated political motives. Yet Booth has often been dismissed as a crazy, drunken actor, the son, after all, of a famously crazy, drunken actor. Some have enlarged their condemnations. In the final volume of his massive Lincoln biography, Carl Sandburg was compelled to reach deep into the supernatural to find words charged with evil sufficient for his portrait of the assassin. If the Good Friday murder had worked to transform Abraham Lincoln into a sort of American Christ figure, a hero who gave his own life so that his nation might live, it wasn't hard to figure out what that made of Booth himself, the American Judas. But who was this Booth? Sandburg asked. In what kind of green poison pool of brain and personality had the amazing and hideous crime arisen? He had now wrapped the letters of his name with a weird infamy synonymous with enemy of mankind. His name on 1,000 occasions was to go unspoken with loathing for the unspeakable and untouchable. A pitiless, dripping, carnivorous, slathered, subhuman and anti-human beast mingling snake and tiger. The unmentionable, a lunatic, with an unstrung imagination, a mind deranged, a brain that was a haunted house of monsters, of vanity, of vampires and bats of hallucination. In recent years, however, there has been increasing recognition that the shot from Booth's little pocket pistol was not a bolt out of the pathological blue, neither an act of psychosis or drunken frenzy, nor the monomaniacal bid of a failed actor to win for himself a name that would belong to the ages, and not an act driven by rivalry to overshadow his more famous brother Edwin, but rather a political murder that can be understood only in the context of the most violent period in American history. However misguided he may have been, John Wilkes Booth was not a monster. He was a highly successful actor and a rebel secret agent. He was an impulsive young man who shared the conviction of millions in the North as well as the South that Abraham Lincoln was a malignant tyrant whose policies threatened to expunge the liberties that had long been the birthright of free white Americans. Booth believed that he acted for his country and for the so-called white race, and he did so with the expectation that the killing would make him a hero. While it is uncertain how much drink contributed to the unhappy man's deterioration, it is clear that Junius Brutus Booth was an alcoholic. One acquaintance offered the not very helpful observation that Junius Brutus Booth was only crazy when he was drunk, but that he was drunk nearly all the time. Alcoholism is a disease that grows progressively worse. Booth's case followed this familiar, dreary, and ultimately terrifying course. Alcoholism also tends to run in families. Junius's father, Richard, was a veteran boozer. All his sons would battle their own thirsts. In the weeks before the assassination, many noticed that John Wilkes Booth was putting away brandy by the quart. Intemperance was an occupational hazard of the 19th century stage. As one actor wrote of the American theater in mid-century, these were the days when liquor drenched the stage, and few there were who escaped the flood. Junius Brutus Booth spoke for himself when he said that, among actors, the temptations to drunkenness here are too common and too powerful for many weak beings. He tried to stay sober, and he once wrote Marianne, "To avoid drinking, I make every effort." But all too often, his resolution dissolved in a flood of liquor. Stage manager soon learned what to expect when they booked the great Junius Brutus Booth. A sold-out house and the chance of an absent or incapacitated star. Surely a theatrical nightmare of the first order. They began taking extraordinary measures, with varying degrees of success, to keep the tragedian sober enough to make his curtain calls. One of the better stories concerns the time a manager locked Booth in a hotel room to keep him off the bottle until the curtain went up. The ingenious star bribed a bellboy to fetch a bowl of liquor that Booth proceeded to inhale through a pipe stem stuck through the keyhole of the door behind which he was imprisoned. Before long, Booth could no longer be trusted to go on tour alone. So his sons were drafted as his traveling guardians. First to serve was the eldest, Junius Brutus Jr., June. As the son's own theatrical career began to take off, however, he cut himself free from his father. The job passed to the next son, Edwin Thomas Booth. Edwin was a middle child. Born in 1833 on the night of a spectacular meteor shower, Edwin was 3 years older than Asia and 5 years older than John Wilkes. He went on the road with his father when he was only 14. Edwin Booth would one day be acknowledged as America's greatest actor. He learned much of his art by touring with his father, but protecting the afflicted man was surely a sad and lonely duty to impose on a child. Chapter 3. Cast. Junius Brutus Booth had been able to win himself a measure of peace when, about a year after arriving in America, he found a place to settle. The farm, about 25 miles north of Baltimore, would be his welcome retreat from the world and beloved childhood home of the brood of little Booths the couple hastened to produce. The rural obscurity also held out the hope of keeping the actor's second illegitimate family from prying eyes. All the Booth children, except Junius Brutus Jr., the first, and Joseph, the tenth and final child, were born on the farm hidden in the northern Maryland countryside, a mile or two from the little rural hamlet of Bel Air in Harford County. The two Britons who settled there were city people. Their London, with its 1.5 million inhabitants, was the biggest city in the world. The farm was a different world, not wilderness, but a still wild place where paths dwindled away in a vast forest, where ancient frogs croaked mightily in swamps, and fallen leaves hid a scattering of stone projectile points lost by aboriginal hunters. The Booth children would be creatures of both urban and rural worlds, growing up on the farm in an enchanted, timeless place. The farm remained a summer home for the Booths until after Junius's death. The family also kept a townhouse in Baltimore, where they usually passed the winters so the children could attend city schools. During their childhoods, Baltimore was successively the second and third largest city in the United States. The Londoners may have found the adjustment to country life challenging. There were other differences. Were Booth and Marianne surprised by the contrast between the democratic equality white people in the United States enjoyed and the rigidly hierarchical class system that ruled society and the constitutional monarchy they had left behind? They didn't say, but both seemed content to stay in America for the rest of their lives. Except for a few brief visits, they never considered returning to Europe. Of course, Booth had other reasons to stay in his new country. The wife and son he'd abandoned when he ran off with his flower girl. Yet there remained a fundamental difference between class-conscious England and the egalitarian Maryland that was of far greater significance: the presence of African slavery. The American way of fixing the value of people was more rigid and pervasive than all the hierarchies of social class that obtained in Europe. The Republic's boasted equality of free white men was a reality, the consummation of the noblest ideals birthed by the world-changing American Revolution. This egalitarianism was unmatched in any of the nations of the Old World. At the same time, the ultimate worth of individuals in the United States was immutably determined not by wealth or high birth or the lack thereof, but by artificial distinctions of physical appearance. standards that derived from the unscientific concept of race. Journalist Isabel Wilkerson has recently suggested that the American model is best understood as a caste system, analogous to the social system that has persisted for millennia in India. The most important pillar of any caste system, Wilkerson maintains, is the preservation of the purity of the dominant caste by confining marriage and childbearing to other members of that caste alone. In America, the dominant caste is the so-called white race. So the most reprehensible of all crimes was any pollution of the purity of whiteness by the admixture with the blood of lesser races. Most white Americans, and particularly most Southern enslavers, were unutterably opposed to what they called amalgamation, that is, race mixing or interracial marriage. The enslavers' ultimate end, and they believe most persuasive argument in their defense of slavery, was the conviction that enslavement prevented race mixing. So slavery was most important not primarily as a labor system, but as a means of preserving white racial purity. Junius Brutus Booth himself refused to become an enslaver, though he could easily have afforded such purchases. Still, John Wilkes Booth grew up from infancy in a slave society. There were no real plantations in the area, but many of his neighbors owned small numbers of people. These people generally considered human bondage a natural and unremarkable part of their world. Young Booth absorbed such attitudes. Many of the African Americans the Booths lived among were free people. A free black woman helped raise the Booth children. When they were grown, she stayed on as a cook and housekeeper, virtually a member of the family for decades. Other blacks, mostly those who labored on the farm, were enslaved men leased from owners who had no need of their labor. So Junius Brutus Booth, although he rejected human bondage, participated in the slave system by paying rent to slaveholding neighbors. This leasing arrangement, common in Maryland and the Upper South, was rare in the Deep South cotton states where the plantation regime was based on torture and the threat of torture, and enslaved people were much more tightly controlled. Some Upper South enslavers even allowed the workers they leased out to keep some fraction of their wages. Many of these workers saved their pay for years to buy their own freedom, or the freedom of family members. Indeed, slavery in the Booths region of northern Maryland, bordering the free state of Pennsylvania, was perhaps the least harsh example of the institution that could be found in America. The reasons were largely demographic. There were fewer African Americans in the state. Moreover, a great many Maryland blacks were free people. When farming for grain crops had eclipsed the labor-intensive planting of tobacco in the Upper South during the 18th century, the labor of enslaved people was needed less. Some surplus slaves were emancipated by their owners. Many more were sold out of the old Chesapeake tobacco colonies, sold south down the Mississippi to the booming cotton states. There, the cultivation of that export crop was making millionaires out of some big planters at a time when $1 million was a truly prodigious amount. The big cotton lords worked hundreds of enslaved people on vast plantations that could be defined as labor camps. They were eager to buy more laborers. So the vast fortunes made by cotton planting in the Deep South swelled the prices of the surplus people owned by Upper South enslavers. The sale of people remained a significant source of revenue for enslavers in the Upper South and border slave states throughout the antebellum period. Each of these sales shattered a family, separating, almost certainly forever, husbands from wives, parents from children. Tearing apart loved ones was the cruelest of the many wrongs inflicted by slavery. The unending grief brought on by this sundering of family ties was a kind of emotional death suffered by people still among the living. The defenders of slavery tended to ignore this atrocious practice. Maryland was unique among the 15 slaveholding states at mid-century. Free blacks there were almost as numerous as the enslaved, representing 41% of the black population, a ratio greatly surpassing that of any other slave state. The second highest proportion of the free to enslaved was neighboring Virginia's much smaller 10%. There were virtually no free blacks in the seven Deep South states that that would one day be the first to declare their secession. Fully 99.7% of the African Americans in Mississippi, for example, were enslaved. Also, unlike Maryland in the Deep South states, black population was nearly equal or greater than the white population. In some regions, enslaved blacks greatly outnumbered whites. Yet in Maryland at mid-century, African Americans, freed and enslaved, constituted only 28% of the state's population. As a boy, John Wilkes Booth had come to regard African Americans with contempt. Nigs and niggers, he called them, and to believe that their ancestral degradation was the happiest condition to which they could aspire. With most white Americans of his time, Booth shared the conviction that blacks were an inferior people, incapable of living alongside whites as free men and women. In the wild speech Booth wrote, but never delivered during the 1860 secession crisis, he declared, "I hold enslavement to be a happiness for themselves and a social and political blessing for us. I have been through the whole South and have marked the happiness of master and of man. Take every individual and you will find the happiness greater there than here. True, I have seen the black man whipped, but only when he deserved much more than he received." The young actor lived among blacks all his life, interacting with them on a daily basis. After he left his mother's house, he had no home. He lived in hotels and boarding houses, ate in restaurants, drank in saloons, and spent days in steamboat parlors and railway carriages. Black people carried out most of the menial tasks in such venues. Most of the waiters who served his meals, the chambermaids who made his bed, the bellboys who carried his bags, the servants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.